Good evening, everyone. Welcome to iFocus Online Lecture 168, and it's the Retina Session 20. And today we have with us Dr. Manvi Sindhil, and she'll be talking on hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations. I request Dr. Ritesh Narula, sir, to please introduce, ma'am.
Thank you, Rolika. Very good evening to all of you. It's indeed a pleasure for me to welcome Dr. Manvi Sindhil here. Dr. Manvi is a head of clinical retina and training at Arvind Eye Hospital, Pondicherry, alumnus of Shankar Netralaya, Chennai, a real avid teacher, researcher with a lot of publications. A special area of his interest have been in retinopathy of prematurity, hereditary vitreoretinal degenerative conditions. And so we are really happy that ma'am is here today to really help us understand this tough topic, that is hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations, and looking forward to hear from you. Thank you. So, Dr. Can we have your screens, please?
Good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for inviting me to this platform of iFocus. And I think everybody is very familiar with this platform and the excellent lectures that there are here. And it's indeed a pleasure to have me and my lecture also a part of this series. So I should be presenting a complex topic of hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations. And I really hope that at the end of my lecture, it would be much more simplified for everybody, and the postgraduates would be more happy to read this very complex topic. So to start off with, hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations, how are these defined? Most commonly used definition is a condition which is an inherited vitreoretinopathy that shows congenital abnormalities of the vitreous, which may be severe degeneration or a maldevelopment. They also have associated with early onset progressive cataract and an increased predisposition to regvatogenous retinal detachment. So what is very important when we look at a case of a hereditary vitreoretinal degeneration is that when you look at just one single patient, what you can do is narrow down a differential diagnosis. But by examination of the family members, this helps us to arrive at an accurate diagnosis, which is very important because most of these conditions are also autosomal dominant. And a correct diagnosis can help the family not receive correct education about the condition, and also can be educated for the importance of follow-up, which is necessary for the management of retinal detachment or cataract that can develop over a course of time. In the course of this lecture, along with what are the Stickler syndrome, enhanced S-cone, the chromosome 5 retinopathies, Snowflake, Edwirk, ADNIV, I will also cover congenital X-linked retinoschisis and family exudative vitreoretinopathy. These last two conditions are sometimes not included in the HVRD collection, but since these are what we clinically and often see more often, I thought I should include them in this lecture. So Stickler syndrome or the other chondral dysplasias, which are associated with vitreoretinal degeneration, these usually show a combination of midface hypoplasia and hypognathia. They can have bifid uvula and can also have a cleft palate, which can be submucosal or it can be a frank cleft palate. They are associated with congenital anomalies of the vitreous, cataract, and a very high rate of retinal detachment. And what is important is that a recent retrospective study has shown that prophylactic treatment can reduce the rate of retinal detachment, making the identification of these patients and their affected family members important. These conditions are associated with genetic mutations, most commonly in Stickler type 1, in the collagen 2A1 gene, and this is the most common form of Stickler's. Stickler's 2 is associated with mutations in collagen 11A1. There is also a Stickler's 3, which has mutations in collagen 11A2, but this is a non-ocular form of Stickler's. So if you look at the features, these are images from the publication, you can see the mid-facial hypoplasia and the micrognathia. And these are the two distinct forms of vitreous changes described in Stickler 1 and 2. So in Stickler 1, you have this membranous type of a phenotype. In Stickler 2 is this what is described as a beaded type of phenotype. And in the fundus, what is often seen as this radial perivascular pigmentary degeneration. So this distinguishes by an ophthalmologist of the two types of vitreous is very important. So the type 1 or membranous vitreous, which is seen as a folded membrane behind the lens with advanced degeneration of vitreous behind it, and the type 2 or the fibrillar vitreous, which has a fibrillar and beaded appearance. The reason for this is that the collagen genes are very large and they are very difficult to screen for mutations. But if we can differentiate between these two types of vitreous degenerations clinically, we can guide or targeted genetic screening can be done for these patients. The cataract which occurs in them is comma or wedge-shaped, and it can present in childhood. Glaucoma is relatively uncommon. In retina, we see radial paravascular chorioretinal degeneration and radial lattice degeneration. The difference between these two being that the lattice degeneration has vitreous condensations which overlies the atrophic retina, whereas the paravascular chorioretinal degeneration does not have any vitreous condensation. Regmatogenous retinal detachment can occur in more than 50% of patients, and the retinal breaks are often large giant retinal tears, or sometimes you can even have large posterior breaks. So the ocular complications are presumed to arise due to the reduced dose, or what is called as haploinsufficiency of the collagen 2A1 gene because of nonsense mutations. When managing this case, the cataract is best managed by phacoemulsification with closed fluidics because there is a lack of vitreous support in these eyes. And as I mentioned, prophylactic cryotherapy applied in just behind the pars plana in contiguous spots all around the ora in a retrospective study has shown to have an 8 to 10 fold reduction in the incidence of retinal detachment as compared to the control arm which had not received this cryotherapy. Retinal detachment, if it occurs, has to be managed most often by pars plana vitrectomy and intraocular tamponade agents. The other related contour dysplasias, there are many of them. To name a few, kinase dysplasia, which happens due to the collagen 2A1 mutation, can be autosomal dominant, which has a short trunk dwarfism, or an autosomal dominant form with normal stature and phalangeal epiphyseal dysplasia with brachydactyly. Marshall syndrome, which happens due to collagen 11A1 mutation, has early and severe hearing loss and more pronounced facial abnormalities. The Knobloch syndrome, which is autosomal recessive, is associated with vitreoretinal degeneration and a congenital occipital encephalocele. Moving on to the next of these conditions, which is the enhanced S-cone syndrome and the associated Goldman-Farrell capitoretinal degeneration. So this occurs due to mutations in the retinal nuclear receptor, that is NR2E3 genes, which are involved in suppressing cone proliferation during retinal development. And this leads to this group of diseases, usually referred to as ESCS. And very rarely, when this is associated with vitreoretinal degeneration, is what is called as the Goldman-Farrell condition. So the classical presentation of ESCS is with nectylopia, cystoid macular changes, and pigmentary retinal degenerations, which is seen in a very typical pattern around the arcades or up to the periphery. Vitreous degeneration, peripheral retinoschisis, and cataract are usually not seen in this condition. The electroretinogram is quite characteristic, which shows absent rod isolated response under dark adaptation. And the rod cone dark and light adapted waveforms are similar with delayed and broadened responses, as we can see here. So this is the image of how a classic fundus appears, where periarcade you have this very granular mottled kind of pigmentary changes. The OCT can show cystoid changes, or there's a loss of definition of the various lamellae or the layers of the retina. And here, if you see the ERG, a normal and of the two affected patients, so this is the dark response, which is reduced or absent. And these are the combined rod cone responses. This is in the dark adapted state, and this is in the light adapted state. And here we can see these responses are broadened, they are delayed, and they are largely negative responses. So what happens in this is that in the presence of the cone rod homobrox protein, that is CRX, the gene NR2E3 binds to the opsin promoters, to promote transcription of rhodopsin while repressing conopsin. So when you remove NR2E3, it is thought that the CRX and NRL leave immature rods, and these immature rods develop into S cones. And the classic fundus arises because the region just outside the orchids normally have the greatest density of rods and are thus most susceptible to the degenerative changes and change into this cone-like ECSS photoreceptors. Moving on to the next, chromosome 5 vitreoretinopathies, the main among which is the Wagner syndrome. These occur due to mutations in chondroitin sulfate proteoglycan that binds hyaluron in the vitreous. And what we see in Wagner's is a congenitally optically empty vitreous with preretinal vitreous condensations. Pseudoexotrophia and progressive chorioretinal degeneration are the typical findings. So in early life, they present with pseudoexotrophia, pseudostrabismus. This is because the macula or the fovea is displaced temporally. There's an optically empty central vitreous cavity, and there are preretinal membranes which can extend from posterior pole to the periphery. These are associated with other congenital anomalies like microphthalmia, ectopia lentis, iris atrophy, a persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous, and also sometimes tractional retinal detachments. The progressive chorioretinal atrophy can lead to severe loss of vision, and up to 75% of cases in some pedigrees have been seen to develop retinal detachment. The nectylopia is present early, and the final dark adaptation thresholds are elevated. ERG, which may be normal in early life, over time shows reduction in the scotopic B wave, diffuse cone-rod loss, which ensues as chorioretinal atrophy, and later on becomes extinguished. And depending on these changes, the visual field correspondingly can show a ring scotoma or advanced field loss. So what happens is that there are many variations in this CSPG2 gene which occur. And this basically what these mutations cause, there's a 40-fold increase in the splice variants without exon 8 and a 10-fold increase without exon 7 or 8. So what is the basic roles of these two exon 7 and 8 is that they contain the glycosaminoglycan attachments, which supports the chondroitin sulfate side chain aggregation. And this is what helps support the vitreous gel formation. And it's in the absence of this that the vitreous gel formation is hampered, leading to this optically empty vitreous cavity. The next among this is snowflake vitreoretinal degeneration. It's not a very common condition. It is caused due to mutations in the KCNG13 chromosome, which is on chromosome 2Q36. And this causes disruption of transport of potassium through the channel. Now, because of the localization of KIR7.1, which is the protein product of KCNG13 to retinal pigment epithelium and internal remitting membrane, it is thought that this mutation could alter the development of vitreous through altering nodular cell function. And this condition receives its name from the minute crystal-like deposits which are seen on the retinal surface when these cases are examined by contact lens biomicroscopy. So the key features are fibrillar degeneration of the vitreous, optic nerve dysmorphism, peripheral areas of retinal pigment epithelial degeneration, corneal guttae, and retinal cysts, retinal crystals. And ERG shows elevated dark adaptation and reduction in the scotopic B wave in dim light conditions. Snowflake vitreoretinal degeneration has been classified into four stages, the first of which is extensive white without pressure. The second one is snowflake degeneration. The third is sheathing of retinal vessels and fundus pigmentation. And in the last stage, there's further pigmentation and there's a disappearance of the peripheral retinal vessels. Associated congenital anomalies are optic nerve head dysmorphism and fibrillar degeneration of the vitreous. And progressive ocular features are corneal guttae and the degeneration with the crystalline deposits. Coming to a couple of another relatively rare conditions, one which is very acutely called ADVIRC or autosomal dominant vitreoretinochoroidopathy. This arises from mutations in the same gene as which causes Best disease, that is the VMD2, and is characterized by this peripheral annular pigmentary dystrophy of the retina. It has a very characteristic appearance. In the far periphery, you have this pigment distributed, and the light rise of the electrooculogram is decreased, which gives rise to a reduced Arden ratio. So this peripheral annular pigmentary dystrophy extends from ora and to a variable distance posteriorly. And the posterior margin, but still is usually anterior to the vitreous, is a sharp, distinct border between the degenerated and the normal, and sometimes can have a hypopigmented border. Fibrillar vitreous degeneration with vitreous cells is sometimes seen. Rarely, we can have neovascularization in the optic disc or posterior retinal surface, which can cause vitreous hemorrhage. Some cases have macular edema, and some are associated with anterior segment abnormalities like nanophthalmos, microcornea, angle closure, and congenital cataract. It is said to arise because of a single base pair sequence variants that create both missense mutation and alternatively spiced messages, which give rise to this condition. And these mutations lead to a mutated BMD2 protein products with both amino acid mutation and one or more in-frame deletions. Another condition is ADNIV, that is autosomal dominant neovascular inflammatory vitreoretinopathy. This is caused by mutations in the CAPN5 gene located on the chromosome 11q13. And this is the first non-syndromic gene which has been identified for an autoimmune uveitis, and is also a first case where a gene is identified for a Mendelian autoimmune disease. The ERG in the early stages shows a reduced B wave. With the later on, there's selective loss of B wave in the scotopic bright flash. And dysfunction of signal transmission from photoreceptors to membranes of inner retina, that is the bipolar cells, occurs due to this localization of the CAPN5 to the photoreceptor synapses. Moving on to the later two conditions, which I mentioned, congenital X-linked retinoschisis. This is an X-linked inherited degeneration characterized by splitting of the superficial layers of retina. Characteristically, this split occurs at the nerve fiber layer. It's the most common of juvenile macular degenerations, and its prevalence ranges from 1 in 5,000 to 1 in 20,000. Congenital X-linked retinoschisis occurs almost exclusively in males. Sometimes carrier females have rarely been reported to have changes in the fovea. X-linked recessive disorder, this is a disorder which has complete penetrance and variable expressivity. So we see a lot of variations in how the patients present to us. And the mutation is in the retinoschisin 1 gene on the distal short arm of chromosome X, which encodes for the protein retinoschisin. The characteristic classical feature which is seen clinically in all of the affected males is the foveal schisis, which has a very distinct appearance, which may on casual examination appear similar to cystoid macular edema, but this is very typical with the stellate kind of a radial arrangement of the small cyst around the center of the fovea. And this is classically described as the bicycle spoke wheel pattern. And peripheral retinoschisis is seen in about 50% of the cases. And this occurs most commonly in the inferotemporal quadrant. It is classified into four types. The type one, which is the foveal schisis. Here the schisis is limited to the fovea, and that is to the area as is seen on clinical examination, and there is no peripheral schisis. Type 2, or what is called foveolamellar, here along with schisis in the fovea, you have this lamellar schisis extending throughout the retina beyond what is clinically apparent on examination, and there is no peripheral schisis. Type 3 is complex, where you have peripheral schisis. If you look into this part of the image, this is where there's a peripheral schisis cavity in this particular example. There is foveal schisis and there is also lamellar schisis. So there are all the three components, and this is the most common phenotype seen in about 71% cases. And type 4 is where you have foveal schisis and you have peripheral schisis, but there's no lamellar schisis. This is relatively rarer. And these retinoschisis can be exudative or non-exudative. So here is a cavity which has got a lot, then this is the schistic area, and there's a lot of subretinal exudation here. The exact cause for this exudation is not known, but there are various hypotheses that it could be either due to resolving vitreous hemorrhage, it could be due to vascular incompetence, or a combination of both, or some reason that is not really yet defined. What happens in this is that these retinas in the schistic areas, especially the areas of peripheral schisis, develop inner and outer retinal holes. So the inner retina, which is just the nerve fiber layer that is detached, is actually very thin, and it almost disappears off. and it develops these large inner retinal breaks, and the membranous remnants are often referred to as vitreous veils, but this is actually not a correct terminology, since these veils are not just vitreous, but they have the remnant retinal tissue as well as retinal vessels in them. And the inner retinal blood vessels are often absent, or sometimes they just cross into the vitreous or just seen hanging like thin threads in the vitreous, or sometimes they may course over the outer part of the retina. And the holes can also develop into the outer retina in these cases. So this is an image which we had published a short time ago. So this is a scysis cavity. Here is the area of foveal scysis. And this particular child, this is his scysis cavity. This is the inner layer of his retinoscysis seen by the red arrow, which is actually completely disappeared. Just a small remnant is here. And this is the outer layer, which has got multiple holes in it. And he has a retinal detachment due to these multiple breaks, which is more obvious in this part of the image. And there's subretinal gliosis also here due to chronicity. The inset shows his other eye, which shows the foveolamellar type of scysis in his other eye. These children can develop retinal detachment, which is rhabdogenous in nature because of the simultaneous development of inner as well as outer retinal breaks. Or sometimes when they develop a posterior vitreous detachment, they can develop full thickness retinal breaks like in any other person. And tractional retinal detachment can occur due to traction from the retinoscysis. So the scysis itself can cause traction at the area where the sciatic and the normal retina meet. Or the hyoid. So the hyoid in whatever is the sciatic retina is very adherent. So there, if it contracts, that can also cause a tractional retinal detachment to occur. Some of the other features that we can see in these cases of congenital X-linked retinoscysis are vitreous hemorrhage, which can occur due to multiple reasons. Some of them being neovascularization either at the disc or in the retina, which is fairly unusual. The more commoner cause is rupture of these unsupported blood vessels which are traversing in the vitreous cavity. Very rarely, they can develop neovascular glaucoma. The retina, other than the inner retinoscysis and foveoscysis and lamellar scysis and the holes, can also be dragged nasally because of the sciatic process, can have changes in the retinal pigment epithelium, can develop intraretinal blood cysts because of bleed from the traction on these vessels into the retina. They can develop sheathed and occluded vessels in the periphery. And very rarely, a very fascinating form, which is called as a dendritiform pattern, is seen, where you have this full dendrite-like appearance of the retina in the periphery. The peripheral retina in examination can also have the metallic or the tapetal reflex, which is associated with the Muzio Nakamura phenomenon, similar to what is seen in Ogochi's disease. So in a light-adapted state, the retina shows a tapetal reflex or a bright silk sort appearance. On dark adaptation, this appearance of the retina reverts to that of a normal retina. So if you look at the electroretinogram in this case, there is a reduction in the dark adapted B wave amplitude, even in eyes with scysis confined to the fovea. And a combination of decreased B wave amplitude and normal A wave results in an electronegative ERG. And the young patients can have a normal A wave, but with progressive involvement of photoreceptors, it goes on decreasing. So to manage these, the peripheral retinoscysis with or without inner retinal breaks is usually observed because of low rates of progressions. Prophylactic treatment of the peripheral retinoscysis is controversial because sometimes the scysis can spontaneously regress, but trying to treat prophylactically carries the risk of creating full thickness breaks in the sciatic cavity, which can lead to the progression of the detachment. And as such, a barrage of the sciatic cavity cannot really prevent the progression of scysis because the scysis is occurring due to a genetic mutation causing a change in the adhesion molecules present in the retina. The associated strabismus, refractive errors, and amblyopia, which occur due to this condition, have to be addressed by appropriate refractive correction and other modalities. Some reports have said that the use of a topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitor can cause a reduction in the foveal or peripheral retinoscysis, but this is not really proven by any trial. When a retinal detachment does develop in these children, they require classical vitreoretinal surgery, which is a pars plana vitrectomy. The induction of posterior vitreous detachment over the scysis is very difficult. And very often, the inner wall of the sciatic cavity is just removed off. and the tamponade with silicone oil is required in these cases. Moving on to the final condition to be discussed today, that is familial exudative vitreoretinopathy, or what is called as fever commonly. This is a rare inherited disorder of retinal angiogenesis. Now, even though literature says it is a rare disorder, we do see this fairly often in our population and fairly often in our clinics in multiple various forms and features. So what is important is to elicit the history, birth history in patients who present to you with these features of fever. The vitreoretinal signs seen in ROP and in fever are very identical, but there's a lack of history of prematurity. The second thing is the signs of ROP beyond a certain point will usually regress. As in, an immature retina of a baby at birth is going to either develop ROP, which needs treatment, or Lansen sequelae if untreated, unfortunately. Or if it does not develop ROP, will progress to vascularization uphill periphery. But patients with fever continue to have the peripheral avascular retina for the whole of their lives. So there are multiple genes identified to be linked with fever, and they can be autosomal dominant, recessive, or X-linked. Out of the multiple genes, four of them have been shown to have a central role in the norim frizzled 4 signaling pathway. And that's why there's again a crossover between the genetic basis for fever and Norrie's disease and also some amount of retinopathy of prematurity. So it also suggests that this particular genes also have a role to play in retinal angiogenesis. And the LRP5 mutations can cause osteopenia and osteoporosis, also an important point to remember. So what are the different clinical features? So the hallmark of fever is peripheral retinal vascularity, which can often have the V-shaped pattern in the temporal periphery. And the mild cases can be asymptomatic and are very often just detected when they come for a routine eye examination. They tend to be quite often associated with mild myopia, and a regular peripheral examination can show this area of peripheral vascularity. The moderate to severe cases can show various changes which can occur at the junction of the vascular and avascular retina in the form of neovascularization or fibrosis. These can cause traction on the retinal vessels or on the macula and can lead to macular ectopia or a drag. And depending upon the extent of these changes, it can lead to visual dysfunction. So here are two images where there is some amount of macular ectopia in this particular, whereas here there is quite a significant amount of a drag happening. So retinal detachment can occur in quite significantly in these individuals, and the reported incidence in literature varies between 21% to 64%. These detachments can be rheumatogenous, tractional, or serous. Rheumatogenous is due to breaks which develop in the avascular peripheral retina, which is very thin. This avascular peripheral retina also shows a lot of multiple rows of these lattice degeneration kind of changes and can develop multiple breaks in that area. A tractional detachment can occur due to fibrosis or neovascularization, which occurs at the junction of the vascular and avascular retina. And a serous detachment can occur due to telangiectatic vessels which develop again at this border and which can exude. Sometimes the traction, even if it doesn't cause a detachment, can lead to retinal folds. Less commonly, there can be a secondary epiretinal membrane. There can be retinoschisis in the periphery due to traction. Neovascularization and vitreous hemorrhage can occur. There can be secondary glaucoma, phacolytic uveitis, retinal capillary angiomas. There can be remnants of the vascular hyaloid remnants and a persistent fetal vasculature also in these cases. Fever staging has typically been there in literature and has been quoted in all kinds of books and textbooks. And these stages, again, are slightly similar to those that you see as the ROP stages. So you have the stage 1 to 5, where 1 is just the avascular peripheral retinal periphery. Stage 2 is where you have extraretinal vascularization. Stage 3 is detachment not involving macula. Stage 4 is detachment involving macula. And stage 5 is a total. For stages 1 to 4, A is without exudation and B is when you have exudation into the retina. And stage 5A is an open funnel configuration and stage 5B is a closed funnel configuration. Now, what is important to understand here is that fever is a congenital failure of retinal vascular development. And the disease rarely progresses. So this is not exactly a stages through which it's going to progress. So going back to the similarity that I have used so many times is retinopathy of prematurity when you talk of the stages, or diabetic retinopathy when you talk of mild, moderate, severe, and proliferative diabetic retinopathy. There is going to be a progression through every stage. That is not what happens with fever. So these have been described as stages. These are differently seen depending upon the genetic manifestation of the phenotypic variation in people. Some can just have an avascular retinal periphery for the whole of their lives, and to the other extreme, you can have children born with bilateral close funnel detachments due to fever. Of course, the extraretinal neovascularization or the exudation due to the telangiectasias can keep on increasing over time, which will need treatment. So here are a few examples. So this is what is described typically as stage one. And here, when you clinically examine, sometimes the peripheral avascularity may not be obvious, but on wide field angiogram, you can see that. And this venous to venous looping is a characteristic feature of fever on fluorescein angiography. So and in stage two, you have this slight telangiectasias over here, which can leak, and you have vascular loops and non-perfusion. Retinal folds can occur due to various degree of traction. So basically, in these cases where you have retinal folds, there has been some extraretinal neovascularization occurring at the edge, which has contracted and has caused these changes to occur. Classically described as a falciform fold. And falciform fold, this is one of the most important cause of a falciform fold seen in a young child. So when coming to the management, it is very important to have this DEXA scans to assess the bone mineral density. And if these are positive, we need to refer them to a rheumatologist for bisphosphonate therapy. So treatment is required only in cases where there is progression or high risk of progression. So that is, the normal avascular retina does not need any treatment. It can just be observed. Cases which have the development of telangiectasias or some abnormality in vasculature, if there is no exudation, even those can be observed. It is only when signs of exudation are seen that treatment is indicated for them, which is usually in the form of a laser photocoagulation, focal directed laser photocoagulation to these telangiectatic vessels in the periphery, delivered through an indirect laser ophthalmoscopic delivery system. Sometimes when the patients come to you later or the exudation is very massive, we may need to do cryotherapy, a double freeze thaw for these telangiectasias to cause their regression. If retinal breaks develop in the avascular peripheral retina, then those need to have barrage. But very often, even despite barrage, if these fever patients have breaks, they do progress to a detachment. And in case of a retinal detachment, they need a retinal reattachment surgery, which depending upon the location of these breaks, which can very often be multiple, can be even a scleral buckling or a partial vitrectomy as the condition may be on the basis of the breaks. So with this, I come to almost a conclusion of what I hope was a lecture which everybody could understand. To briefly just revise all that we went through. So the classical hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations, we have Stickler type 1 and 2, which is autosomal dominant, which is caused due to the COL2A1 and COL11A1. They have associated myopia, cataract, a retrolenticular membrane in type 1, or a fibrillar and beaded vitreous in type 2. Optic nerve macula is normal. They can have radial perivascular retinal degeneration, or they can have radial and circumferential lattice. They develop anterior giant retinal tears or posterior large tears, and a high incidence of retinal detachment associated with midface hypoplasia, micrometnia, hearing loss, arthritis, and other changes. Knobloch syndrome, a relatively very rare entity, which is also due to the collagen gene 18A1, has myopia, nystagmus, cataract and subluxated lens. There is some degeneration of the vitreous, and macula and also myopia related changes. The enhanced S-cone syndrome, the ESCS syndrome, is an autosomal recessive, which is caused due to the NR2E3 gene and have usually a myopic refractive error. The vitreous is normal, but if it is degenerated, then it's called the Goldman-Favre syndrome. the macula can show cystoid changes. Classical appearances, these pigmentary degenerations along the arcade and peripheral degenerative clumps of the pigment. And the ERG, retinal function, ERG shows the enhanced S cone, that is the negative response with the broadening of the A wave to being extinguished in the late stages. Advirk, autosomal dominant vitreoretinochoroidopathy, is autosomal dominant due to the VMD2 gene, which also causes Best disease. Vitreous can be almost normal to fibrillar degeneration. This characteristic is here is in the periphery. You have the sharply demarcated circumferential peripheral retinal degeneration from the ora sedata to a variable distance posteriorly, but which lies anterior to the equator. And this can have a sharp border of demarcation and has a lower rate of retinal detachment associated, can have a depressed Arden's ratio with variable reduction in ERG. The Wagner's disease, that is caused, is autosomal dominant due to the CSPG2 gene. This has myopia, it has pseudostrabismus with a positive angle kappa because of temporal displacements of the fovea, can have cataract and anterior segment dysgenesis associated, has an optical empty vitreous and can have optic atrophy. And they have perivascular pigmentation, sheathing, progressive choroidal atrophy, and tractional regmatogenous retinal detachment. They present with nectylopia and have impaired dark adaptation with progressive reduction of ERG. And snowflake vitreoretinal degeneration, autosomal dominant, with the KCNG13 gene, they have myopia. They can have corneal guttae and cataract, which are the progressive changes. They have fibrillary degeneration of the vitreous. Optic nerve can be flat or hyperplastic in appearance. And they have this peripheral sheathing, radial degeneration, and these minute crystalline deposits on the inner surface of retina, which gives the name snowflake degeneration, with focal RP degeneration, vitreous condensation. And they have reduced dark adaptation and scotic B wave reduction in dim light. Genetic abnormalities have been noted by humanity for a long time. A very interesting article I came across, which shows the representation of various genetic anomalies in classical art. This is Adoration of the Christ, a very famous painting which is found in the New York Metropolitan Museum. And you can see that there are people depicted here who have what appears to be facial anomalies. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful lecture. You have described the one very difficult topic for postgraduates to understand in a very simple way. Pratish, sir, would you like to say something?
Yeah, first, I would like to comment about the last photograph. Real gem of a photograph you,
thank you.
You found out. And yeah. That is really nice.
Thanks.
Before she asked question, I had a question. Amongst your practice, which is the commonest degenerations that you...
Definitely by far fever. We see a lot of patients with the familial exudative vitreoretinopathy. More often we see the ones which have breaks and retinal detachments. Again, if I was to say more than 75%, and this is just a rough estimate, would be of that category. And a smaller proportion with the telangiectasia than exudation. But we see a lot of them in our regular practice. Routinely, I'm operating on these cases routinely. And we do see congenital X-linked retinoschisis. Yeah. Maybe something that we think is stickler once in a while, but as genetic testing is very difficult to be accessible, they often don't get examined, to be frank.
Right. Oh, maybe you have a practice which is so pediatric, high volume practice. Amongst my practice, also I see fever a lot often, but we do tend to suspect more fever rather than have classic fevers, wherein they come with detachment. We tend to see more of patients with peripheral avascular zones with no prematurity. Those maybe we get lesser severe conditions compared to what reach up and then reach to you, because we generally are not operating such conditions here. So probably that could be a difference. What are there any questions, Rolika?
Yes, sir, there are a few. Would you like to take your questions first, or would you like me to?
I think let's take the questions first.
Ma'am, how often do you see fevers cases which are to be operated, like operable zone, as sir has mentioned right now, that very, very, very less do we see the classical fever where we can go and operate?
Yeah, interesting question. So again, like I mentioned in this, there's a lot of variation in the way fever presents. And I agree with Dr. Ritesh, we very often see these patients who are babies with fever are not so often seen. We do sometimes come across babies who are brought to us at a few months of age without history of prematurity and a close funnel RD, where we presume the diagnosis may be fever and we ask for the parents to be screened, and sometimes with a falciform fold. The more common presentation that we see is with the avascular retina, with the peripheral retinal breaks who come to us with retinal detachment, very often at a young age. So these can be pediatric cases up till the first, up to the age of like 25 or 30. And they have that very typical junction of demarcation between vascular, avascular, thinning of their peripheral retina with breaks. And that's what we call, that's also part of fever phenotypes. That's very often seen. Also some fever adults with dragging, traction ectopia, some telangiectasias with leakage at different age groups.
Right, ma'am. And ma'am, what is the earliest stage that you have seen the diagnosis of fever?
I have seen the diagnosis at the earliest age. I have an interesting story about a child who was initially seen at our hospital, had visited Sankar Netralaya, LV Prasad, everywhere, who was taken by his parents around the age of 7 to 10 months and was diagnosed with a falciform fold. And eventually by the age of 2 or 3, this child went to a closed funnel retinal detachment. The mother had a second child whom, despite me counseling her to get the child to me soon after birth, she presented with the baby at the age of around 7 months, when the child had multiple telangiectasias and neovascularization occurring at the junction of the vascular avascular retina. So those are the ones that I know for sure, which I could clinically call as fever.
Right, ma'am. And ma'am, two last questions associated with fever would be like, how often do you see a bilateral case presenting to you? Unfortunate, but...
Yeah, almost all of them will be bilateral. So because it's a
bilateral end stage.
Bilateral end stage, we do see sometimes, very unfortunate. Yeah, it does happen because people tend to present late and they don't really realize that a child has a problem until it goes into the second eye. So yes, we do see that.
Okay, ma'am. Is it too?
Can I just add a point here?
Yeah,
very often it also happens that the other eye is not screened. The kid has one eye vision loss, and we do tend to see these eyes by when you're talking about, by, as Dr. Manvi was saying, they are very late presentations in fever compared to ROP. So you have these bilateral cases where the patient had an opportunity to be seen, the other eye to be seen, but was lost, and the patient has presented with bilateral disease. So bilaterality is a norm which should be looked at in such cases.
Okay, sir. Ma'am, is it a possibility that fever cases present with an intermediate uveitis? There's a tractional component on the optic disc, the way we have seen.
Is this question leading to, can we misdiagnose fever with something like a toxocariasis or something like that?
Yes, ma'am.
If you look at one eye, maybe yes, but if you look at the other eye, it usually helps you know the diagnosis, because there will be some extent of changes in the other eye also, whereas toxocariasis is going to be unilocular. And toxocariasis, again, very classically has the membranes extending from the disc and going to the periphery. You can also see the granuloma, where the traction and the membranes in fever do appear different. So at least for experienced vitreoretinal surgeon, I don't think there should be much of a confusion. But sometimes I do agree there may be some element of crossover. And like you say, sometimes when they come to you in late stage with something like falciform fold, like I mentioned in the earlier example, which I gave, you really don't know what caused it sometimes. So you are presuming it was fever, some sort of.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, there's a question by Sony, and that is that... could you please point out about temporal vessel straightening? Is it always for fever, or it points towards any other condition also?
So temporal vessel straightening can occur even as a sequelae of ROP. So where some stage of ROP develop, it can also cause a drag and straightening. And then the later on the retina matured. So that could be one of the cases. Milder forms of other degenerations like nori's and all can also have. But then again, without a history of prematurity, at least in the kind of population I treat down here, I would think of fever. Dr. Ritesh, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I agree with you there. I totally agree. Straightening typically is seen with FEVR and ROP, that's what I would say. Other diseases are so rare in presentation. Generally, they don't cross our mind with when you see temporal straightening. First question generally we ask is history of prematurity. Once that comes out as negative, we examine the other eye, look at the family history, and we come to FEVRS.
I completely agree. Completely.
Just to add to it, how often are you getting a white field angiography in such conditions? Do you more rely on clinical or you are mostly getting an FEVR case?
No, we do rely usually on clinical, but when we do suspect some amount of changes in the vasculature, what can be seen clinically, or extraretinal neovascularization, or sometimes, you know, the junction has a very fibrous kind of an appearance, then we go in for a wide field angiography to see if there is anything significant happening there.
And to plan your laser if you...
If we need, yeah.
Ma'am, there is another question that how do we differentiate metallic sheen retina as seen in Noguchi disease and the one seen in juvenile retinoschisis?
So the thing is, the tapetoretinal reflex in Noguchi's disease is something which is very classical in appearance. And once you have seen it, you know, you're never going to really forget it. It's got that golden, greenish, metallic bronze kind of a shiny, well-shined bronze kind of an appearance, which is very good. The appearance is not so prominent when you see it in a juvenile retinoschisis and not so frequent also. The other thing is the associated other retinal conditions, like other than the tapetoretinal reflex, the Noguchi's retina looks perfectly normal and they come to you complaining very strongly of nectalopia. Like even patients with RP will not complain to you as strongly of nectalopia as a patient with Noguchi's will. They're usually brought by the time they're 8 or 10 or 12 or even sometimes younger age by their parents that, you know, this child keeps on stumbling in the dark all the time. So those factors do help clinching the diagnosis, and retinoschisis is going to have the classical features, especially the foveal schisis, which we just discussed, is always present.
Right, ma'am. And ma'am, how often do you see Noguchi disease getting masked by retinitis pigmentosa?
No, it doesn't. There is no crossover in the Noguchi's is congenital stationary night blindness. It has that tapetoretinal retinal reflex, which you can also blindfold the child into a dark room for 20 minutes and a quick look, because as soon as you expose the retina to light, it bleaches the rhodopsin off and it's back to the tapetoretinal reflex. And the ERG findings with the negative waveforms are quite classic, but there is no pigmentary changes or mottling which happen in these cases. So there's not much of a chance of a misdiagnosis.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, Sony has a request for you to emphasize a little on pseudogliomas.
Pseudogliomas. Okay. That's a bit out of this thing.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. It's okay, ma'am, if it can be taken up in another class. That's fine.
Sure. I think that would be better.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, these are the questions that are available on the social media for now. I'll gather more. Till then, Ritesh sir can continue the discussion that you people will have.
Thank you, Rolika. Dr. Mani, a word about barrage, prophylactic barrage laser. How do you plan it out? Do you take a different kind of an approach when you are dealing with these vitreoretinal conditions when you're doing your barrage? How much is the risk of barrage-induced traction, holes, detachment because of barrage?
A very valid point. So in cases of fever, again, I would not barrage it unless I see a hole. And at times I would just barrage around the hole, because as you know, these avascular areas have those what appear like lattices, but they're not typical lattices, those lesions. Because what I have seen is that they do not stabilize with the barrage. Like most of the time when I'm seeing a kid who's got a detachment in one eye and has classical features of fever, I may or may not see a break in the other eye. But by the time I'm done dealing with the one eye and I've done the surgery and I've kept my oil and at 3 or 4 months later, 5 months later, it's all stable and I'm trying to remove, they do develop some extent of detachment, starts occurring in the other eye also. And they do need bilateral surgery. the only good thing is because the other eye is happening when we are observing it, very often we can operate on those eyes before it becomes a macular involving attachment and can give them better vision. Even with that, sometimes they may need multiple surgeries and have recurrences, like the better eye can also have recurrences. So I would not be very aggressive in barrage. I personally am not a big fan of barraging, even normal lattices and all, you know. I would go conservative on it. I would be more comfortable educating the patient and the parents to keep coming back to me and do a very light barrage to extreme full thickness breaks, which I see in the periphery.
I think we have had, like, at least I have burned my fingers with excessive barrage and had bilateral immediate detachments the moment you have gone a little more aggressive with your barrage in these eyes. But as you said, in Stickler's, Wagner's, barrage and cryo have a prophylactic role. Very often they have a very kind of a overlapping kind of a picture. You can't differentiate A from B. So would you recommend that means a patient who has someone, a lot of perivascular lattices. So would you now say that preferably to treat them?
Again, like you just mentioned that some time ago, you also were mentioning that we rarely see these conditions. They're not very common in our practice. And we just hypothetically diagnose them because genetic testing is not happening. So like you say, we call it Stickler, Wagner, hereditary vitreoretinal degeneration. These patients, when they have an extensive of these perivascular lesions, they can be quite extensive sometimes. And even that barraging becomes really very difficult. And you'll probably be doing something like a, almost like a PRB kind of a thing or something. So again, in these kind of cases, sometimes if they have peripheral breaks and all, I try to do targeted barrage for those lesions and keep them under a close watch. I think most of these kind of cases, I usually see them when they have already got a thysis in one eye and they come with a detachment in their only seeing eye. And that's when they come to us for treatment. And we are trying to salvage that only seeing eye.
They're pretty tough surgically also. We tend to, a couple of times you have taken up a young patient for surgery and then on table you realize what you're dealing with is not a normal vitreous and you're not dealing with, it's an FEVR kind of a situation. And they're very tough. Yeah. Vitreous to separate. Yeah. Yeah. Rolika, anything else has come up?
Ma'am, an interesting question is that how many times do you see vitreoretinal degenerations or FEVR in general misdiagnosed as retinoblastoma? Because we do see some cases which come like that. How often do you see the reverse, ma'am?
I don't have much of a retinoblastoma practice. Actually, at my particular center here in Pondicherry, we don't do ocular oncology. So I would not be seeing them as many as you would get referred. I have seen coats being misdiagnosed as retinoblastoma quite a few times. I have had people panicking and coming to us and me diagnosing coats. But yeah, FEVR and those fractional folds can also get misdiagnosed. Yeah. It's basically people, I think, want to err on the side of safety.
Yeah, they preferred not having.
Not missing the tube.
Yes, ma'am. That's true.
That's what I was about to say. I mean, working with Vikas Menon for so many years, he would any days be happy for over-diagnosing retinoblastoma, investigating and ruling it out, rather than under-investigating and missing it out.
Sure. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah.
That is absolutely true, sir. That's true, sir. These are all the questions that we have, sir. So for now, that's the portal that we have.
Thank you, Dr. Manvi. That was quite an interesting topic and quite an interesting discussion. Your slides are really going to be a good resource for any student to quickly brush up this topic. Summary in the end would really be very useful. Thank you so much for such a lucid talk. Thank you.
Thank you for having me on this platform. And I really hope I've done justice to the topic.
Definitely, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. Our next class will be on January 12th. That is macular dystrophies. And it's an international master class again by Professor Elitson. See you all there. Thank you so much, ma'am, for being here.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, Ritesh, sir, for taking the discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Ritesh. Thank you, Rolika, for carrying it out wonderfully.
Thank you, ma'am. Have a good night.
Good night, everybody.